Hey guys, it's me, Pavitra, and the video I've been talking about so much on Twitter is finally here. We're going to talk about ULA's Vulcan-Centaur rocket, which will have its maiden flight sometime in 2021, carrying the Peregrine lunar lander developed by Astrobiotics Technology to the surface of the moon. We'll do this step by step. First, I'll give you an overview of what Vulcan-Centaur really is, and then we'll talk about the individual parts of the vehicle. There are some really interesting facts and figures about Vulcan in this video, so you might want to stick around till the end. Let's get started. Vulcan is a space launch vehicle that the United Launch Alliance, ULA for short, is developing. ULA is a governmental agency formed in 2006 in a time of crisis when all the telecommunication satellites that were put up into orbit years ago were approaching the end of their service lifespan, and there were limited ways of putting war. So Boeing and Northrop Grumman came together and made ULA, bringing together their Atlas and Delta series of rockets, upgraded versions of which fly even today as the Atlas V and the Delta IV Heavy. So far, ULA has had a perfect track record, with not even one of the over 140 launches failing. All of these were either Atlas or Delta launches, but ULA plans to slowly phase out these older rockets and replace them by the Vulcan-Centaur launch vehicle. Now, this is a simple two-stage vehicle with options to put 0, 2, 4 or 6 solid rocket boosters on it. It employs two of Blue Origin's BE-4 engines on the first stage and two RL-10CX engines developed by Aerojet Rocketdyne on the second stage. Overview complete. Now let's work our way up the rocket, first talking about the little solid rocket boosters on the bottom. These are the Gen 63XL SRBs. GEM stands for Graphite Epoxy Motor. 63 indicates the diameter of these SRBs in inches, and XL stands for extra long, as these are about 1.5 meters longer than the Gen 63 standard SRBs. These rocket motors are powered by an HTPB propellant, short for hydroxyl terminated polybutadiene. The rocket motors are 22 meters long, about 1.6 meters in diameter, or 63 inches as indicated by the 63 in the name, and they have 48,000 kilograms of propellant inside of them. They burn with an average thrust of 2026 kN and have a burn time of about 84 seconds. Now that we are done with the SRBs, let's look at the core stage of Vulcan. This will be powered by two of the BE-4 engines, or Blue Engine 4, produced by private rocket company Blue Origin, founded by the founder of Amazon, Jeff Bezos. These BE-4 engines run on liquid oxygen and liquid natural gas, better known as liquid methane. It is a staged combustion cycle engine with an oxygen-rich pre-burner and a regeneratively cooled nozzle. Staged combustion here is not to be confused with full-flow staged combustion like the one SpaceX's Raptor has. This only has one turbopump to power both the liquid oxygen and the liquid methane turbines, unlike the Raptor engine, which has two separate turbopumps for the two turbines. If you want to know more about how rocket engine combustion cycles work, then I'll point you to Tim Dodd, the Everyday Astronauts video about the Raptor engine. It contains everything you need to know about it. The link will pop up somewhere above me, and I'll also put it in the description. Coming back to BE-4, it is one of the most powerful engines in production with an impressive thrust of 2400 kN. It also has deep throttle capability. What that means basically is that it can throttle all the way down to 40% power. This isn't really going to benefit ULA in any way, but the same engine is also being used on Blue Origin's new Glenn rocket, which intends to reuse a first stage, and deep throttle capability allows easier landing. Now even ULA has some plans outlining how they would be reusing the BE-4 engines on the first stage, because the BE-4 engines are designed to be able to be reused about 100 times, and throwing away an engine that is capable of performing 100 flights is dumb. So ULA plans to jettison the engines on the first stage after it has completed its burn and stage separation has taken place. Then an inflatable heat shield and aerodynamic brake will deploy and slow down the engines while they re-enter the atmosphere. And then finally, once the engines are slow enough, the parachutes will deploy and a helicopter with a hook will come and grab the engines by the parachutes. Now this might seem crazy, but this has actually been done before. A lot. Earlier in the day, when there was no way to beam back information from spy satellites down to Earth, the recorded film followed a similar recovery pattern. The film would enter the atmosphere and deploy a parachute, and then a helicopter would scoop it up. In my opinion, this is a good engineering choice, as you don't have to go through the pain of figuring out how you will land the booster, but you still recover the engines, which account for 65% of the cost of the first stage. Coming back to the BE-4, it has a chamber pressure of 134 bar, which is significantly lower than the chamber pressure of some other popular engines like the Russian-made RD-180 with a chamber pressure of 260 bar and the Raptor engine approaching chamber pressures of over 300 bar. And because of the chamber pressure being lower, even the specific impulse will be lower than what methane engines can usually achieve. And now that we're done with the BE-4 engines and the first stage, let's look at the second stage of the vehicle, aka the Centaur 5 upper stage. First off, the Centaur 5 on the Vulcan is a bigger, more upgraded version of the Centaur 3 upper stage currently being used on the Atlas V. So let's put them both up on the screen and compare them. Let's look at their sizes first. Both of them are the same height at 12.6 meters. The Centaur 3 is 3.1 meters wide compared to the 5.4 meters for the Centaur 5. This greater size allows Centaur 5 to store about 2.6 times more propellant than the Centaur 3. The Centaur 3 has a propellant mass of 21,000 kg, including both the oxidizer liquid oxygen and the fuel liquid hydrogen. The Centaur 5, on the other hand, has a propellant capacity of 54,000 kg, and even this uses liquid hydrogen and oxygen as its fuel and oxidizer. Now, a tiny fraction of you might have grabbed a calculator to calculate the increase in volume, and you might have noticed that the increase in volume is 3 times, but the increase in propellant mass is only 2.6 times. What is the other space used for? There can be various reasons for this. I suspect it is the oxidizer to fuel ratio in the tanks. Perhaps the oxidizer to fuel ratio was decreased so that there is more hydrogen available to burn in oxygen. Hydrogen has a lower density than oxygen, so decreasing the ratio will decrease the average density and the propellant will take up more space. Hydrolox engines usually have a higher than optimal oxidizer to fuel ratio because of the low density of liquid hydrogen. So decreasing the ratio could bring it closer to optimal and it could explain the increased specific impulse of the upper stage, something I will mention later. Moving ahead with the comparison, the Centaur 3 has a single RL-10C1 engine which produces a thrust of around 106 kN. On the other hand, the Centaur 5 has two RL-10CX engines which have slightly more thrust than the RL-10C1. So the two of them will give a total thrust of a little higher than 212 kN. The RL-10C1 has a specific impulse of 450 seconds and the RL-10CX engines have a specific impulse of 454 seconds, slightly better, and as I said, this could be due to the decreased oxidizer to fuel ratio. But we are just being purely speculative here. We have no indication from ULA or CEO Tory Bruno that this is the case. So take these predictions with a tiny grain of salt. Now let's look at what the Centaur upper stages are made of. Both the Centaur 3 and the Centaur 5 are made of stainless steel and they are pressure stabilized. This means that the stages are not capable of bearing their own weight if they are not under pressure from the propellant. Vaguely similar to how an inflated balloon is more capable of standing under its own weight compared to an airless balloon, which would just flop around. The walls on these upper stages are thinner than a dime, with the thickness in Centaur 3 being 0.51 mm and the thickness in Centaur 5 being 1.07 mm. And the last major thing that is different for the Centaur 5 is actually one of the biggest changes in the upper stages, its reaction control system. The Centaur 3 has a reaction control system fueled by hydrazine, but ULA switched to hydrogen peroxide for the monopropellant in Centaur 5. This has several benefits. First of all, hydrogen peroxide is so much less toxic. When dealing with hydrazine, workers have to wear what looks like a spacesuit so they don't inhale the lethal fumes. And while hydrogen peroxide is also a mild toxin, it is much safer than hydrazine. Secondly, the hydrogen peroxide can give a slightly higher specific impulse than hydrazine. So it's a win-win. Now, moving away from the comparison, I have some other super nerdy information about the Centaur upper stages. The Centaur 3 has 20 RCS engines placed around the upper stage in 2 thruster and 4 thruster parts. 150 kg of hydrazine fuel is stored in a set of bladder tanks and it is fed to the RCS thrusters using pressurized helium gas, stored in composite overwrapped pressure vessels, also known as COPVs, which we know thanks to Tory Bruno are made by filament winding graphite epoxy over a thin-walled steel or aluminum liner. Basically, what this means is that a thin-walled metal container is used as the storage unit for the pressurized helium gas. But since it cannot hold a lot of pressure itself, graphite epoxy is wrapped around the liner to allow it to contain more pressure. Compare this to how a plastic bottle will be able to contain more pressure if I wrapped a lot of thread around it. Furthermore, the Centaur upper stages, both the 3 and 5, have a common dome between the liquid oxygen and the liquid hydrogen tanks. This basically means that the LOX tank and the LH2 tank share a common wall. This helps cut down the weight of the stage. But the reason this is challenging is that LH2 has a very low boiling point and LOX boils off at a relatively warm temperature. So sharing a common dome means that heat would transfer from the LOX to the LH2. This would boil off the LH2 and freeze the LOX solid. This problem is overcome by having the common dome made of 3 layers. The first and the last layer is stainless steel, and sandwiched between them is a fiberglass honeycomb structure to minimize thermal energy transferring from the LOX to the LH2. And now that we are done with the upper stage, let's move on to the last part of the rocket, the fairing. The fairing on the Vulcan-Centaur is made of a vented aluminum honeycomb core and graphite epoxy phase sheets. Basically, an aluminum structure strengthened by graphite epoxy. Graphite epoxy is a material that has quickly gained popularity in rocketry, as it has a high strength to weight ratio and a thermal expansion coefficient of almost zero. This means that it expands little with a change in temperature, making it suitable for space applications where extremes of temperature can be experienced. The Vulcan-Centaur is available in 3 fairing configurations: the standard fairing, the long fairing, and the multi-manifold fairing. The standard fairing is 5.4 meters wide and 15.5 meters long. The long fairing is also 5.4 meters wide but 21 meters long. It has a total volume of almost 320 meters cubed. The multi-manifold fairing is the same dimensions as the long fairing, but it has a secondary payload adapter. Think of it like a small fairing inside a big fairing. The big fairing has a primary payload and the small fairing inside it, and the small fairing has the secondary payload and or CubeSats inside. And now we are done with the entire rocket. We started a few minutes back at the bottom and worked our way up the vehicle, passing the BE-4s, the SRBs, spiraling up the booster and meeting the RL-10CX engines on the second stage, and then nerding out a little with the second stage itself. And then we finally made it to the fairings. Now let's have an overall look of the launch vehicle. All of that together make the Vulcan-Centaur rocket, a 67 meter long beast capable of taking 27,200 kilograms of payload to low Earth orbit in the heavy configuration. The stripped down configuration with zero SRBs has a payload capacity of 10,600 kilograms to low Earth orbit and cannot go to geostationary Earth orbit. The 2 SRB configuration has a capacity of 18,500 kilograms to low Earth orbit and 2,600 kilograms to geostationary Earth orbit. 4 SRBs give the Vulcan a payload capacity of 23,900 kilograms to low Earth orbit and 4,800 kilograms to geostationary Earth orbit. And finally, it's 27,200 kilograms to low Earth orbit and 6,500 kilograms to geostationary Earth orbit for the 6 SRB configuration. The thing that I feel is the most incredible about the way ULA is developing Vulcan-Centaur is that most of the components of the rocket are being tested before the vehicle even flies. The large 5.4 meter fairings have been tested numerous times on Atlas V launches. Even the Centaur 3 upper stage is being flown for years on the Atlas rockets, and there is not significant difference between the Centaur 3 and 5. Many of the major things are the same, like the pressure stabilized stages and stainless steel bodies. Centaur 5 is just bigger and has some other small differences. Smaller versions of the Gem 63 solids have flown on the Atlas V NROL-101 launch, taking a classified military payload to space. The Atlas V today shares 80% of the flight software and the avionics with the Vulcan. The only thing that is really not going to be tested on other rockets beforehand are the BE-4 engines. This way of development really makes the rockets more reliable and could be the reason why ULA has a perfect track record. I really want to see ULA continue on as an aerospace company. Every step taken is a step taken towards the ultimate goal of human colonization on other celestial bodies. So that's it for this video. If you liked the video, then don't forget to tap that like button. And if you did not like the video, go ahead and tap the dislike button. Tap it twice. Also, this video is part of a series where I talk about all the methane-powered rockets that have sprung up into development lately. So don't forget to subscribe and hit that bell icon so you don't miss out on any of the next videos. Thanks for watching. See you later.